Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we're going to talk about Giannis Antetokounmpo and the Milwaukee Bucks winning their first NBA title in nearly 50 years. But before we hop into all that, you know we got to give a quick shout out to our subscriber today, as always. And today is going to be Jordan Blaze. Thank you so much for like, commenting, and subscribing, turning on post notification, and showing so much love and support towards our YouTube channel and our podcast overall. We greatly appreciate it. But let's dissect Game 6 of the NBA Finals last night, because this one was a thriller. It was historic from an offensive standpoint and an individual standpoint from Giannis Antetokounmpo. He led the way with 50 points, you know, contributed 10 rebounds, 5 blocks on the defensive end, really did a good job of taking away DeAndre Ayton. But Greg, what are your thoughts on Giannis's play, and how do you think that last night's individual game will affect his legacy in the near future?
Giannis's play last night was incredible, and it was very, very dominant. Like, he showed that he can really carry a team, and shown that he can carry, finally can show the media and the critics that he can carry a team to a championship and really do his part in all facets of the game. Defense, offense, anything, effort plays, 50-50 balls. He did it all. 50 points, 14 rebounds, 5 blocks, giving maximum effort. It's going to boost his legacy and his trajectory to, you know, the GOAT or top 5 power forward all time, top 25 player, any of those discussions. He's going to be in it because of his accolades in this play, that he, in his unique play style. I mean, this is a guy who doesn't shoot a lot of threes and people criticize him for that, but a guy that who can score in the paint at a high efficient rate and really just get buckets for his team and really get everybody involved as well. So I think hats off to Giannis. You have to give him credit for developing his game since his rookie year and always getting better and knowing the things that he needed to work on to really put his team in position to be where they're at. NBA champions. So they deserve it, and he deserves it.
Yeah, and I think the fact that, you know, he's already got 2 regular season MVPs, which is already more than Kevin Durant alone, and the fact that, you know, he's been able to, you know, finally showcase that he can win a title at the highest level and, you know, just be able to, you know, take advantage of whatever the defense gives him on a night-in, night-out basis. I mean, this guy, he averaged around 30 and 15 this entire postseason. I mean, this is not something that is just a walk in the park. Not too many players are capable of doing this, even some of the best players in the entire NBA. And, you know, with all that being said, we really just have to take a bow down and take our hats off to Giannis Antetokounmpo, what he's been able to, you know, accomplish throughout his entire career. Now he's finally can hang his hat on and saying, given the fact that, you know, he's an NBA champion and all that. But let's talk about how he was able to accomplish this with Game 6 last night. I mean, Milwaukee, they did a good job of, you know, just keeping him the focal point of their offense. I mean, but it started off on the defensive end. I mean, him contributing 5 blocks, a lot of those were towards DeAndre Ayton. He really did a great job of, you know, taking him out of this entire series these last 3 or 4 games, because DeAndre Ayton, he's shown that when you add some size and, you know, you have a opposing defender that's, you know, just as good as him defensively and, you know, is stronger than him, he's gonna struggle, given the fact that, you know, he's not all that great when it comes to, you know, creating his own shot and everything. And then that led to a lot of transition buckets for the Milwaukee Bucks. I mean, and Giannis was, you know, the leader when it came to that. You know, him being able to get downhill, you know, just finish over the top of guys, finding guys like Bobby Portis and Pat Connaughton in transition. Jrue Holiday, he was also able to, you know, get going a little bit from a defensive standpoint. I would say offensively, we all know he struggled, 4 of 19 from the field. And then same thing with Chris Middleton. I think he finished the night 6 of 13. But it's just so great to see a guy like Giannis Antetokounmpo finally reach that mountaintop and achieve all of his goals.
Yeah, I hats off to him, because you have to respect his journey. You have to respect the journey and him, his loyalness to staying with Milwaukee and doing it the right way, not joining a super team, quote unquote super team, and doing it the right way. And hats off to him. But yeah, you have to give credit to the rest of the Bucks team. I mean, Jrue Holiday, how he played Devin Booker last night, making him inefficient, cutting off his lanes, making him turn the ball over. Devin Booker had 6 turnovers last night, just really making it uncomfortable for him and not making him get to his spots and usually do the things that he likes to do on the floor. And I didn't think Cam Johnson or Mikal Bridges showed up tonight and didn't get a lot of touches either. He didn't get a lot of shots. And I thought Chris Paul, they tried to get Chris Paul going, but late in the game it just didn't work out. And the Bucks, at the end of the day, showed why they were so dominant this whole year. It started on the defensive end, and it started with Giannis, started with Jrue Holiday, it started with PJ Tucker and Bobby Portis, and it showed last night.
Yeah, and I think Phoenix could have been a lot better when it comes to, you know, just their offensive set. I felt like towards, like, when it once we got to, like, game three, I feel like Milwaukee was able to, like, figure out their game plan, and they were able to, you know, use that to their advantage on the defensive side of the basketball, because we all know Devin Booker, he's going to be able to operate in the pick and roll. They're going to have him come off some curl action, operate towards the free throw line. The same thing with Chris Paul. We saw them mix it up a little bit with the Spain pick and roll, which was effective. They were able to get guys like Jay Crowder and Cam Johnson some shots out of this. Even DeAndre Ayton, I think he might have made one field goal out of this formation. But other than that, Phoenix was not – they were getting subpar looks for the better half of the night. I mean, you talked about Devin Booker being inefficient when it comes to, you know, his shot making and the quality of looks that he was getting. They were just very subpar. And, I mean, what do you have to add to this, man?
I mean, just the way that Jrue Holiday really guarded him on the pick and roll, making it tough for him, getting to the body of him, cutting off his lane, cutting off the anticipation. I mean, Jrue Holiday is very good on that side of the ball and just made it really tough for him. But I thought Devin Booker was really just, at some moments, I'm not saying the whole game, some moments, try to play hero ball and try to shoot himself back into the game. And just, you could just feel the pressure that he tried to really put his team back in position to win the game. It just did not work out.
Yeah, and the fact that Phoenix wasn't able to get too much interior offense within when it comes to, you know, getting points in the paint, I think that really made it a lot easier for Milwaukee to play defense on them. Because ultimately, coming into the season, or coming into this postseason series, Phoenix was shooting 37% from the three-point line. Now, they shot putrid from the three-point line this entire series. They were making, on average, about 7 to 8 threes a game, and that's just not going to be enough to, you know, sustain in today's NBA. And then when you're not getting production from an interior standpoint, it's going to be a lot easier for teams to, you know, just swarm in the restricted area and, you know, things of that nature. And I think that's what really helped Milwaukee from a defensive standpoint, also given the fact that they already have the size advantage and they're the number one rebounding team in the entire postseason.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think, and again, we got to give Coach Bud hats off to him, because he made the right adjustments and he proved to us this postseason that he can make the proper adjustments to lead his team to the championship. I mean, yeah, he's a four-time champion assistant coach with the Spurs and now got his first championships as a head coach. So I think that he proved a lot on the line and really showed that he can lead, you know, this team to another championship.
Right. But I was a bit disappointed in Phoenix's intensity. I mean, the fact that, you know, you take an early lead in the second quarter, you know, you outscore them 31-13 in that quarter, and then you come out at halftime and you let Giannis go off for 20 points in an individual quarter. I think that really didn't do them any good from an offensive or defensive standpoint, ultimately, especially given the fact that, you know, Phoenix has relied heavily on their two-man game, and they haven't been able to really get guys like Mikal Bridges any quality shots. He's been very absent since game two when he scored 27 points. And then we talked about DeAndre Ayton not being able to, you know, be in a situation to really thrive, given the fact that, you know, Phoenix's depth from the center position was very lackluster. So, I mean, there's a lot of things that we can take away from Phoenix's side that they could have done better from an individual standpoint or a team standpoint, ultimately, offensively and defensively. But I just feel like this was the championship for the Milwaukee Bucks to win. I mean, they really deserved it. We saw them overcome, you know, the defending Eastern Conference champions by sweeping them in at on the road at Miami. We saw them head into Brooklyn and, you know, defeat them in a 7-game series on the road. And then they ultimately were able to make it to the NBA Finals by defeating the Atlanta Hawks. But if you're the Phoenix Suns, what are some of your thoughts heading into, you know, next year's season? I mean, we obviously know that guys like Cameron Payne, they might not return. What assets and what, you know, players do they need to add to this roster in order to get over the hump next season?
If they're going to lose Cameron Payne, they need another backup point guard. They need more bigs, because I think relying so much on DeAndre Ayton to get rebounds, to dominate the paint, to dominate the offensive glass, to be a game changer and the only interior force. I mean, Frank Kaminsky came in, played 11 minutes. I thought he gave good energy, but it just wasn't enough. Like, so I think they need to add another big. And we saw that, you know, Sarge going down, that really hurt that team a lot. Like, the value of that guy was very detrimental to that team. So I think adding another big and then figuring out if you can keep Chris Paul and adding more veteran presence to this team, because it's a lot of young guys, and I feel like the pressure of the moment and them just having another voice in the locker room would have been helpful to this Phoenix Suns.
Yeah, I agree specifically with the adding veterans to this roster because, I mean, they were able to acquire a guy like CP3, you know, who's arguably a top five point guard all time. And then Jay Crowder, who, you know, now has NBA Finals experience going back to last year. But I feel like they needed more guys with a lot more playoff experience because specifically NBA Finals experience and guys that were on winning teams, not losing teams like Jay Crowder was last year. Because ultimately, Chris Paul is the leader of this unit and he wasn't able to really lead them because he didn't really know how to, you know, deal with this, with these circumstances, just given the fact that, you know, he hasn't been to this standpoint in 16 years. So I feel like, you know, going out in free agency and, you know, acquiring some guys with a lot of postseason experience, specifically deep postseason experience, yeah, with good success and everything, I feel like that'll be a big help for the Phoenix Suns to, you know, really get over the hump. But do you have any final thoughts before we close out season one of the Ball Fake podcast, Greg?
I mean, hats off to Giannis. He deserves it. I mean, what do you think about Giannis's legacy? Let's hear from you. Like, what do you think about Giannis going forward? Like, will they bring back the same team? Will, if he makes another deep playoff run or gets another accolade, like a regular season MVP, does that make his case for the face of the league, top anything? What are you thinking?
I mean, first and foremost, I think, judging by the roster and the contracts, I think for the most part, aside from Bobby Portis, they should be able to, you know, bring back everybody else that was on this original roster and everything. I'm not sure what PJ Tucker's contract is because I haven't looked at it as of right now. But for the most part, I think that this team could have just started a dynasty by winning the NBA Finals last night. And, you know, with all that being said, I think Giannis is going to have a lot more opportunities to really be able to showcase his talents. And we're only going to see more improvements from him. I mean, we've seen that each and every year within his 7-year, 8-year career within the NBA. And then when you talk about him being the face of the league, I mean, if he continues to be as dominant as he has been these last 3 years, I think there's the league is going to be in big trouble, especially having an international player as the face of the league.
Totally agree, man.
But thank you guys for tuning in to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. We greatly appreciate it. Make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe. Turn on post notification if you're watching on YouTube. And if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. This concludes season one of the Ball Fake Podcast. We thank you guys so much for just, you know, tuning into every single episode. We greatly appreciate it. But besides that, it's your boy, Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host, Greg King. And we out.
We out.